Hi everyone, welcome to our Monday live stream. Great to see you here. Mac made his appearance and now he's off to chase the squirrels. So happy Monday, hope you guys had a great weekend. It's actually not too hot here today. It's only probably in the low 80s. We're supposed to have a really pleasant week in the 80s, maybe get up into the low 90s just a little bit. But I know a lot of you are having crazy weather all over the place. So I wanna thank you for joining me here today. We're gonna talk about tomato issues, tomato problems, and how to fix them. Tomatoes are always a popular topic, and no matter if we're doing everything right, sometimes we still have issues with our tomatoes. So we'll dig into that in just a moment. But I want to thank you for joining me here today, for taking time out of your busy Monday. It's always something I look forward to on Mondays. It's a great way to start the week. And I know a lot of you are having crazy temperature swings. Cliff was saying earlier that he's supposed to get 37 on Wednesday and then 90 on Thursday. So that crazy weather just sometimes doesn't always bode well for the garden, but we do the best we can. Nothing we can control about the weather. So we just make the best of it and do all the tips we possibly can to protect our garden in extreme temperatures, right, Cliff? So I know you always have a great attitude about that and are always willing to share your wisdom here with us on the live stream. So thanks to Cliff and Nisha for moderating. Thanks to all of you for being here. Let's see who's here. Amy Boato, how are you? Nice to see you here. Eric G, above 100 degrees for the next weeks. Wow, crazy temperatures. And LaKeisha Bridgeforth, welcome. Glad you're here. Michelle from Florida, glad you're here. Thank you for joining me here. Claus M, it's my first live stream. I finally made it, went through your videos and you are amazing. Greetings from the Netherlands. Wow, thank you so much. Glad that you can be here today. Deanna Taylor, my garden is in trouble. I've sent you an email. Thank you. Actually, I've had a little bit of an issue getting my email. Dina had some problems with it yesterday, so I may have missed it. So please send it again if I don't respond. I know I got a whole bunch over the weekend, so it may take me some time if you emailed me to get back to you. So please bear with me. Patricia from Arizona, hot there. And she's saying hi to Mac. Erin Jenkins, hello. Nafisha, Debbie, always good to see you, and Jan, the Aloha crew over there. Jackie Perez, Guy, hi from Boston. Lots of people on here this morning, or this afternoon, actually, for most of you, for me too, except for those in Hawaii. So welcome. So let's jump into tomato issues. So I know a ton of you are growing tomatoes. It's actually one of the most popular garden vegetables. I think most people that garden, that's probably one of the first things that they want to grow. Dina, if you go ahead and send it again because my email issues were happening up until probably mid-morning or so. So send it to me again just to make sure that I get it. So anyway, yeah, lots of people growing tomatoes, and right here behind me, these are kind of starting to turn a little bit. I don't know if you can tell here, but these are the Golden Jubilee from my tomato seed collection. I think they're also in my raised bed garden and a couple of different of my seed collections, but they're growing in a 10-gallon CaliKim Smart Pots. Man, oh man, am I loving it. Having this nice little bunch of tomatoes right behind me here. I love the color, a few marigolds spilling over the edge. And these are not some of the ones that I'm having issues with. I'm gonna show you one particular issue that I'm having in just a moment. But no matter if your plants are healthy, no matter if you're doing everything right, I mean, there's so many different ways you can grow tomatoes. Tomatoes are prone to issues and diseases at some point during the growing season. You will probably have a problem or two with your tomato plants. So if you've grown tomatoes before, you probably know that that is the case. Doesn't mean that you're doing anything wrong. It just happens. So even if you feel like you're watering really well, you're feeding your tomatoes consistently, things just happen, right? That's just kind of the way it goes. You win some, you lose some. We were talking about that earlier in the chat, in the pre-live stream chat. And, you know, it's just a matter of being armed and ready to deal with issues when they do come up and knowing a few little tips. Rita, great to see you. I haven't seen you here for a while. It's great to have you on here. And knowing a few little tips and things that you can do to help fix the problem. So there's no sure fixes, but implementing the fixes I'm going to talk about today will definitely give you the best chance of fixing them. And I know there's lots of other solutions out there to the issues we're going to talk about. This by no means is a comprehensive, is not a comprehensive list of tomato issues. We're only going to talk about five of the most common problems today. So if you have any other solutions, then what I mentioned, by all means, jump into the chat. That's what we're here to do on the live streams, is just kind of interact, learn from each other, make some friends, and have a lot of fun along the way. So that being said, let's jump in after I get a drink, excuse me, and talk about the first thing that could be one of the most common issues people have. I know it's usually an issue at some point for me during the summer season, or during the tomato growing season here in California, and that is blossom end rot. So raise your hand or say yes in the chat if you've had issues with that on your tomatoes. And what that is, actually brought a tomato down here with me. Actually, I'm not gonna show you that one just yet. What blossom end rot is, and it's actually very common in container plants, is it's kind of a small, well, it doesn't always, not always small, but a darker area on the bottom of your tomatoes. It looks like the bottom of your tomato is rotting. That's why it's called blossom end rot. It's at the end of the tomato plant, and it's kind of mushy and soft and brown. It does not look very nice at all on your tomatoes. And a lot of times you can still eat the tomato and just cut off the rotted end, but sometimes that, excuse me, that portion will extend into the tomato, and the tomato is very soft and not good for eating. But a lot of times you can't still eat it. Excuse me, guys. So what that is a sign of a calcium deficiency in the tomatoes, which doesn't always necessarily mean that you have to add calcium. It's either a calcium deficiency or the inability of the tomato to take up calcium from the soil. So really a quick fix for that is to go ahead and add calcium. I mean, it can't really hurt your plants to add calcium. There's some really quick acting types of soil drenches that you can use. One is called calcium nitrate. I think calcium chloride, I think they're about kind of the same thing. And I know Gary over at the Rustic Garden has a, excuse me, has a calcium nitrate powder in powder form that you can mix in water and then add to your plants. So you want to check that out over at therustigarden.com. There's lots of prepared sprays that you can grab as well to help add calcium to the soil. Sorry, you guys. I know that probably doesn't sound real good here in your ear, especially if you're wearing AirPods. But a lot of people will crush up eggshells and add that to the soil. That's a great idea. However, it doesn't immediately add calcium to the soil. Eggshells are high in calcium, but you know, they take time to break down. Even if you pulverize them like in your coffee maker or something like that, it's not going to immediately add calcium. So I tend to add my eggshells more to my compost, and then try and fix the watering issue that it might be. So especially in containers, when the soil dries out, when the weather gets really hot, if you're not watering evenly, your tomato roots can't take up the calcium that they need from the soil. So do make sure that you're evenly watering your plants, especially in containers. Drip irrigation is super helpful with that on a timer. That way your containers don't dry out, because when your containers dry out, your plants tend to get stunted and they don't always recover. So do your best to keep your containers evenly moist. You can use a moisture meter to check the moisture in the soil, or you can just use your finger, put your finger in your container, kind of like this here. And my container is on drip, so it doesn't dry out. And you can see here the soil is nice and moist. So these containers don't need water right now. And a lot of times you can kind of pick up your container. This is really heavy, so it has a good water content in the soil. Doesn't need watering, it's doing really well, but do make sure that you water evenly. That will really, really help. And then you can go ahead and add some of that calcium nitrate. You can look it up online or look over at Gary's shop, and that'll help add immediate little boost of calcium to your plant. So with a combination of those two, that should help. But like I said, if your tomato plants or your tomatoes get blossom end rot, it doesn't mean you've done anything wrong. And a lot of times, once you harvest those affected tomatoes, the next round will be fine. So as long as you know, kind of fix the issue that your watering issue or the calcium issue. So give that a try. And I want to hear here in the chat if you've had any blossom end rot issues. It also happens, it can happen on squash or peppers, but it does happen really frequently to container plants. And also the Roma style tomatoes seem to be especially prone to blossom end rot. So if you're growing Roma and that's happening, that could be a reason as well. It doesn't mean you shouldn't grow Romas, but you just kind of want to stay ahead of the game with blossom end rot, especially when you're growing in containers. And then hopefully you can help prevent the problem or fix it on the next round of tomatoes. Okay, let me jump here in the chat, see what questions you have. I already see tomato questions flying by that we're gonna cover a little bit later in the live stream. So we'll be dealing with like a leaf curl. I saw a question about that. And we'll talk about that in a few tips here. Charlene, don't put too much calcium in or you'll burn the plants like I did. Okay, really good point on that, Charlene. Always make sure that you follow the package instructions. If you're going to spray your plants with calcium, which you can, it's called a foliar feeding, and plants do take up nutrients through their leaves. But if you're gonna spray your plants, always do it, you know, on a cloudy day or early in the morning. Always test spray. Don't spray your whole entire plant down, which I've done that too, Charlene, so don't feel bad. Don't spray your whole plant down. Test spray a couple of the leaves on the bottom, and then wait 24 hours, see how it looks. If there's any damage, you might want to adjust the amount of calcium nitrate powder that you're applying with your spray bottle, and then do the whole process again. So you always want to proceed very carefully when you're spraying any of your plants, because you definitely don't want to be growing these beautiful tomatoes and have it loaded down here with fruit like I do, and then kill your plant because you didn't do a test spray. So, Charlene, didn't spray, put too much in the water, and the next day the plant was dead. Yeah, that's always a bummer when that happens. So just do make sure you follow the package directions, and you may want to apply it only to one plant first if that's the issue for you, just to help avoid that happening to all your plants. And Colleen, yes, I've used copper fungicide as well by Bonide. That's a great product. I also have one called Rot Stop, which I used also. So they have a lot of good organic gardening products. So great point on that. Charlene, what a bummer. Didn't follow directions. Well, it happens. You know what? Sometimes we're in a hurry and we just get out there and, you know, throw it on our plants. So, you know, it's all a learning experience. There's no failures. It's only a learning experience. And I'm sure that you learned from that experience as well. And hopefully you'll be able to get some more going. Okay, let's see here. I saw a question. Roger, great point here, and welcome to the live stream as well. Corrected BER, that's short for blossom end rot, by using frost cloth to shade tomatoes. So yeah, we're actually going to talk about that here in just a few moments as well. So great tip. Okay, Claus, have you ever had aphids on tomatoes? I just sprayed them before they were blooming, so no danger for pollinators, but I've never had them on tomatoes. Does that mean they are not strong enough? I'm trying to think. I believe I have had aphids on tomatoes, not typically, but I'm sure I have over the years. And it doesn't necessarily mean they're not strong enough. I mean, pests do tend to attack plants that might be a little bit weaker, but sometimes they attack strong plants too. So, you know, spray them off with water, give them a good dose of neem oil, but do again, do that test spray, and hopefully they won't come back and attack the rest of your plants. Okay, let's jump into our number two problem that probably I get asked the most about tomatoes is, why are my tomato blossoms drying up and falling off? That's a big issue that a lot of people have. And for the most part, that happens when the plant is under stress. Either your, either it's a heat stress where when it gets over 85 or 90 degrees, a lot of you have told me you're in the hundreds already, like in the far south in the desert, like Patricia down in Arizona or Texas, or you know, if you're over in the Middle East somewhere, you might be dealing with temperatures in the hundreds already. And plants don't like those kind of temperatures. There's some plants that can handle it, but tomatoes are not one of them. So what you want to do definitely when it gets really hot over 90, as much as you can, use shade cloth over your plants. And that way they're not under stress. The tomatoes or the blossoms will, it'll help them anyway from drying up and dropping off. And it really does help them avoid some of that heat stress. It could also mean, oh, let me show you a piece of shade cloth here. I brought one for you because I forgot to show it last week. Or I forgot to bring it with me. If you've never used shade cloth, I'm a huge proponent of this. You can see that it's partially see-through. So your plants will get some protection from the intensity of the sun's rays. It can keep them 10, 15 degrees cooler under the shade cloth. So it really does work, especially if you're in a very hot climate, you want to use like a tighter weave or a higher percentage of shade cloth, like maybe a 60 or 70%. This I want to say is probably around a 40%. It's pretty see-through. So it will definitely allow some of the sun's rays to get through, but it really, really helps provide protection for those flowers. Because once your flowers dry up and drop off, then your plant is stressed. It kind of has to start all over with as far as the, producing the flowers, and you've kind of set yourself back a little bit. So all you need to do is just throw this over your cage here. I can't reach the top of my cage. You don't even have to set up any kind of permanent structure. You can if you want to, but you can just throw it over your cages, over your trellises. You might not be able to protect all of your plants, but maybe you can protect a couple of your really special plants that you really want to see produce. And then the other ones might just slow down a little bit and then hopefully catch up. And then once the weather cools off, you can pull it off. And that way your plant can get the full amount of the sun. So the other reason, is Jack on here? Jack, I know you're a big bird person. We've heard this, we think it's a hawk like calling for like 24 hours. I got a picture of it on my phone, but it's just beautiful. We were sitting out last night with binoculars looking at it, and we can't tell, it's too far away, if it was a hawk or a falcon or just what. But Jack, if you hear that calling, during the live stream at all, let me know what kind of bird you think it is, because it's beautiful and maybe you'll recognize the call. So I don't know what's going on in the area, but something's going on because it's been calling for about 24 hours. So anyway, guys, back to our tomato problem. A lot of times if your tomato is not getting enough sun, you may see some of the flowers dropping off, or if you are underwatering and your containers here are just getting, or your raised beds are just getting too dry, your plant again is reacting to the stress. So you can use the shade cloth. Yes, I will, Jack. I will send you a DM this afternoon. So it's kind of a blurry picture, but I'll try and send it to you anyway. It was on the telephone pole in front of our house. So. Okay, so what you can also do to help increase the production of the plant is you can shake the tomato plant to help hand pollinate and produce more fruit. So this one, you can't see the flowers, they're in the back, but tomato flowers have both male and female parts, so they're self-pollinating. So if you walk by your tomato cages and shake them a couple of times a day, it'll help move the pollen around in the flowers, and it'll help produce more tomatoes for you. So give that a try this summer and let me know if that helps you produce more tomatoes in your garden, because it works really, really well. Okay, so, the other thing I wanted to mention too is to keep your tomato plants healthy, and they're gonna handle heat stress better. So I like to do a couple things to keep my plant healthy. We'll talk more about that in a moment, but about one of the things in just a moment. But one of the things I like to do is feed them a lot of worm tea, worm castings, the Vermistera products, because worm casting products are really high in the beneficial bacteria, and that will help keep your plants healthy and really help them manage stress a lot better. So I've really seen a big difference in my plants since I've been using the worm castings. The Vitality is great for that too, and the worm casting tea. And links for that are all in the video description. Okay, jumping back in the chat. Actually, before I do that, I wanna mention, in case some of you weren't on last week's live stream, that Jerry and I are headed out to see Gary from the Rustic Garden in a couple of weeks, actually next week. And we're doing a live in-person event on June 25th. So it's going to be at a place called Freetown Farm. It's in Columbia, Maryland. The links for that will be in the video description. You do need to RSVP. We're just going to be having a good time hanging out. Did I say it's June 25th? Hanging out, there's going to be a plant sale there. It's all the proceeds benefit the farm. We're going to be talking gardening, giving some gardening tips. We'll have our books with us to sign. If you have a book already of Gary's or mine, bring it along. We'd love to shake your hand, meet you, say hello. It's always fun to meet people that we've seen online for many, many years. Camera guy's going to be there as well, and we would love for you to join us there. So do make sure you RSVP. There's a morning session, afternoon session. This parking is very limited, so you do need to RSVP for one of those two sessions. Jack's going to be there, and I know Angela was on last week, and she's going to be there as well. So if any of you out there live anywhere in that area, please come out and join us. It's going to be really fun, and we cannot wait to meet you. Angela, great. She says she's bringing her books for Gary and myself to sign. So Angela, I was telling Jerry that you're going to be there, not Gary, but Jerry, my husband, camera guy, and he's really looking forward to meeting you and Jack. And if anyone else is on here that has already RSVP'd, please let me know, because I'm looking forward to seeing you there. Okay, let's see what questions we have in the chat so far. Charlene, taking the next flight out. That would be awesome. I would love to meet you there as well. Okay, Jay, how are you? Great to see you on here today. Spawn, my over 7 foot tall classic beefsteak is still growing. That's crazy. It reminds me of the plant in Little Shop of Horrors. I think it wants to eat me. Wow, that's nuts. That is so tall. And hopefully you have a nice strong trellis to support it, because it sounds like you're going to have lots and lots of tomatoes from that plant. That'll be a ton of fun. And you're going to have to let us know what you do with all of those tomatoes. Because if you've got a nice healthy plant, it can produce a ton, especially when you have it trellised, doing really well. And by the way, you guys, in front of me here, I'm going to turn the camera around for a second. Our raised bed is just going bonkers. I cannot believe it. It's full sun all day. The soil that we put in it is just nuts. I've never ever had such amazingly large scallop squash. And I think next week I'm going to do a live stream on squash, squash tips, squash issues, how to get your squash to grow big. But it's loving, loving, loving this spot. The back tomato there doesn't get quite as much sun. That's on the right side of your screen. The teepee trellis, the watermelon, is starting to climb. The cucumbers are down at the bottom. You can't see them. There's green beans behind the squash. This raised bed is absolutely going bonkers. And we have totally been enjoying our time here in the chill zone in the evenings. So stay tuned for a special video in a couple of weeks. We're adding something new to the chill zone. So you're gonna love, love, love that video. Okay, let's jump into the chat, see what questions you got going on. Made my announcement here, and we'll see what you got. Connie, great to have you here today. My sun gold tomato plant is almost 3 feet tall and has two main branches from low down. Oops, should I cut one off or leave them both if I have enough space? Okay, two main branches, so it's kind of going like that. You know what? I kind of like to leave that on until my plant gets just a little bit bigger. I wouldn't single stem it quite yet. You may want to wait a little bit. What you do want to do though is go ahead and trim off the lower lying, not the actual main stems, but if you have any branches kind of hanging off the side here, or off the bottom that are touching the ground, you would want to go ahead and cut those. About 3 feet tall, you probably want to just start cutting about 6 inches up. Then as your plant grows, you can continue to trim so you have plenty of airflow under here about 6 to 12 inches up. So give that a go, and then hopefully you get lots of tomatoes from your sun gold. I've got one that's producing already a lot over on the hill area, and we picked our first sun golds over the weekend. So kind of depending on the space, you want to keep it kind of trimmed to manage the size. And those are literally like candy. That is one of the most amazing tomatoes. It's so, so good. Okay, Montana Bean Blossom, great to see you on here today. Still cold here. Tomato plants are growing slowly. Jack, do you hear that? There it is. I don't know how much you can hear. Okay, there's some chickens there too in the background. But anyway, where did we go here? It's still cold here from Montana Bean Blossom. Tomato plants are growing slowly. How long does it take for tiny Tim plant to start getting flowers in? You know what? Once the weather picks up there and it warms up, you're gonna be amazed at how quickly your plants grow. The soil temperature will be warming up, and hopefully you don't go from, you know, cold to hot. Hopefully have some little in-between time there to help things kind of move along. But really, it really just depends on the weather. So it's really hard to say how long it takes. But generally speaking, if you have temps in the 80s and nighttime temps in the 60s, Tiny Tim will go from seed to harvest in about 60 days, give or take a few, depending on the temperature. So hopefully that'll help you know what to expect. Okay, let me do a hawk of some kind. Okay, Jack, thanks a lot. I'll send you a picture there, and hopefully you'll be able to identify it a little bit more. When it calls like that, is there something going on? or it's just been like constant for 24 hours. I love the sound, but I'm just kind of curious, like, what is that hawk doing? Looking for critters to pick up, or is it like in distress or something like that? I don't know. I mean, it's kind of interesting. Okay, so next, you know what? Before I forget here, I did want to mention our video over the weekend on planting your summer salad station, that now is the time, defending a nest. Okay, Jack, we have seen it fly over into a humongous tree. So I have a feeling that might be what's going on. So yeah, good point there. So anyway, if you have not yet planted your summer salad station, go back and watch our video from the weekend. Very popular video. And you don't have to quit growing salads just because the weather is heating up for many, many of you. I want to encourage you to plant heat tolerant greens and watch the video for all the details, like kale, chard. We planted 5 of them on the video. And if you don't have space, we planted them in a little shorty, which I've got, by the way, here. Does that not look amazing? All those beans. We picked our first harvest of beans last night too. But we planted them in a little shorty on the video, but you can also grow them right here in the little 5-gallon smart pot. So if you don't have room to plant them in a raised bed, this actually comes in that's called the heat tolerant salad in a container kit. So it comes with 5-gallon smart pots, a copy of my first book, and the whole heat tolerant greens salad in a container kit seed collection. It has 6 varieties in here with all the directions written down for you. So you really can't go any easier than that. So it makes a great Father's Day gift. You get those 3 things together, the smart pots, the seeds, and the book. And if you want to order for Father's Day though, you do need to order today and pick priority mail shipping for the US, and you get 20% off with the code SUMMER. So lots of great Father's Day gifts over on my website. And today is the last day for that 20% discount. So if you want to grab some for dad, and so that's a good one for this time of the year. And also the late summer garden seed collection is an excellent one for right now too, because there's lots of seeds that you can plant now that are quick growing that can give you a harvest in about 8 weeks. So if you haven't gotten anything growing yet, these would be 2 good options for you to jump right in. And the Tiny Tim tomato is in the late summer, and that's a good quick growing tomato for those of you that may not quite have enough time in the growing season, crazy enough, to plant a full size tomato. Okay, so let's jump into our tip number 3, or issue number 3 that a lot of people have, and that is deformed tomatoes, okay? So we've got our blossom end rot, which we talked about earlier. That's not really a deformed tomato, but sometimes your tomatoes, actually sacrifice one of my tomatoes here, guys, is something like this, where it's kind of lumpy and bumpy. Now, this is a really small example, but this is something on the bottom called catfacing. Let me hold this up to the camera so you guys can see. And catfacing is just kind of either a dried up type of spot right here on the end. It might get lumpy and bumpy even more than this little tiny one is. I have a bigger one on this same plant that is like lumpy and bumpy up here at the top. And you can look up catfacing on the internet and see what a larger size tomato plant looks like. But I've got a plant up on the deck up above, the little kitchen garden up above. And it was really, it was one of the first tomato plants that I planted of the season. And I love Cliff's comment, don't worry if your tomatoes don't look like the grocery store. It's actually a good thing. Yeah, there's always a lot of character, especially the heirloom tomatoes that you grow at home. But it doesn't mean, again, you're doing anything wrong. Sometimes deformed tomatoes or catfacing happens when the temperatures are cold and the plant or the flowers are pollinated when the temperature is a little bit on the cold side. So it's really not a big deal if your tomatoes end up looking a little lumpy and bumpy. Some people get very concerned about this. Even if you have big dry spots like this on the bottom, you can still eat this tomato. Well, not this one, it's green, but once it ripens up, you can still eat them. Absolutely no problem. You can always cut out the spots that you don't necessarily like. But that's usually a common problem when you plant your tomato plants early and it just gets a little bit cold and they get pollinated during maybe a cold night or something like that. So no big deal though. Sometimes that can happen when the temperatures are fluctuating, which I know A lot of us have been dealing with fluctuating temperatures this year in particular. So especially Cliff, 37 on Wednesday and then 90 on Thursday, that's crazy. And we had tons of temperature fluctuations here as well. So a lot of times that will happen. And then once you harvest these tomatoes, sometimes the next round, if you get like another harvest or their go around from that plant, because the temperatures have warmed up now, it will be just fine. But again, no big deal. I mean, you could wait until the temperature is just right to plant your tomatoes, or you can take a gamble like I always like to do, and I know a lot of you do too. Get a couple plants out early just so you can have plants going and early tomatoes. And then you'll have lots of other tomatoes in the garden that probably won't have this problem because you planted them, you know, when the temperatures were just right. So really not a big deal. So nothing to be too concerned about. It certainly doesn't mean that there's anything wrong with the tomato. So it's actually a pretty common problem for a lot of people. Okay, let me see if I covered everything on that. The other thing you can do is, like right now, if you want to plant like a second round, believe it or not, we're already talking about the second round of plants. But you might get your early plants out. Like for me, I got some tomatoes planted the first day of spring. So get your early plants out and then plant another round. Now, if you have the space and the soil is nice and warm, it's just so much easier to get them to take off at this time of the year. Maybe plant some smaller varieties like are in the late summer garden seed collection, like the Tiny Tim, that are smaller. You can stick them in a container or two. Maybe you can, and they will go from seed to harvest a lot quicker than the large varieties of tomatoes. So that will give you a little bit of help on that one as well. Okay, let's jump into the chat here, see what's going on. Erica, seeing that with my bell peppers, sometimes bell peppers also get the blossom end rot, or they can, I think I probably have some with cat facing or deformities as well. Usually deformed fruit is usually a pollination issue, like strawberries can get like that as well. But again, not really a huge deal. And I really kind of like actually the character that the deformities give the homegrown vegetables. It's just kind of fun. So Moam planted a second round and doing well. So way to go. You know what? It just seems like just yesterday, I can't believe how fast this year is going, that we were all like in the dead of winter, talking about snow still, and really waiting for spring. And here we are, guys. Next week, it's going to be the first day of summer. So it's pretty darn crazy, right? Okay, Jan, how you doing? When you want to stop the growth of your indeterminate, do you cut the whole top center growth? If you want to stop the growth, yeah, you can definitely top your tomatoes. You can cut just the center growth, or you can just top the whole thing off, like once it reaches the top of your tomato cage or your tomato trellis. And that will definitely help stop the upward growth. And you may see some bushier growth from your plant, or you may see, you know, extra additional tomato fruit set because your tomato plant's not putting quite as much energy into developing the leaves, and you'll hopefully get more fruit. Okay, Florence, you're welcome. She says, thanks, Kim, for the info on the tomatoes. You got it. Question, how do I get rid of spider mites? Oh my gosh. Sharon, those are nasty, aren't they? We've got a lot of hot, dry weather coming, and spider mites always come in during the hot, dry weather. So I've really been diligent about keeping an eye on my plants. As soon as I see them, I trim off any affected leaves, spray the plant off with water, and then I spray with, I've been using insecticidal super soap by Bonide and also neem oil. So I've got a couple videos on organic pest control. Take a look at those. But again, test spray, test spray, test spray. But do make sure that you check and are very, very diligent about checking for spider mites because they do move very, very fast. Okay, we're gonna move on. Oh, before I do that, I put little announcements in between that I don't wanna forget to tell you guys. This Thursday and Friday, you're gonna wanna tune in over on Instagram. If you don't follow me, CaliKim29, follow Camera Guy as well, he's Cali Camera Guy. But I'm doing an Instagram takeover over at Smart Pots. So check that out. I'll be posting on my page, also over on Smart Pots, giving some summer garden tips and also doing a giveaway. So you don't want to miss that. That's this coming Thursday and Friday. And then get your questions ready because I'll be on a Smart Pots feed and my feed answering questions about the post that I am posting about. So do make sure you go over there, show them some love. They're one of my brand partners, a great company to work with. The Smart Pots team is absolutely amazing. Plus, they produce an amazing product there. So we'll see you over there on Thursday and Friday. Okay, digging into our problem number four, and someone was asking about this earlier, and that is leaf curl, all right? Actually, this plant was affected with leaf curl a few weeks ago, pretty good, and you can see here what leaf curl is. It's when the leaves curl, that's why it's called leaf curl, from the outside, and the leaves just kind of roll towards the inside. And a lot of times this happens when it gets really hot, again, during temperature fluctuations. It's often caused by overwatering or uneven watering, or sometimes even by over pruning. So it's just kind of a little bit of a reaction to stress for the plant. And again, that's not really a huge deal either. Other than that, it doesn't make your plant look super great, but you don't need to go crazy and prune off all the leaf curled branches or stems or anything like that. It's really not a big deal. And a lot of times the problem will correct itself when you correct the issue. Like if you're underwatering and your soil has dried out, just make sure that you're very consistent with your watering. If it's too hot, you might want to throw a piece of shade cloth over, or once the temperature kind of evens out a little bit, a lot of times the problem will correct itself. So there were a couple of branches on the bottom here that I pruned off that were kind of yellowing, but really the plant has recovered very well from the leaf curl, and I think this might be one of the only branches that's still curling. So just hang in there with leaf curl. And a lot of times it's not a big deal. It does not affect the production of your tomato plant. So you can see here, I don't think I had that many tomatoes at the time that I had the leaf curl, but it really didn't affect it. It put on these tomatoes probably within the last couple of weeks, I want to say. I think on the garden tour, you might have had a couple I showed you then, but they're definitely sizing up. There's probably about 10 or 12 tomatoes on this plant. And hopefully they'll be getting a lot more soon. So leaf curl is really not a huge issue. Now, if you're growing in a container that doesn't have drainage, that can make the leaf curl issue pop up too. So do make sure that your containers have good drainage. Again, that's one reason why I love growing in the smart pots, because the fabric is aerated. So the water naturally drains out. The roots are getting a lot more oxygen to them. So you can grow a lot more vegetables in a smaller space when you're growing in smart pots and you don't have the drainage issue that you might have with other containers, or the root circling issue as well. Okay, let me jump into the chat here. See what questions you have. And Heidi, I'm gonna talk about some pruning things in just a moment. So hang on to your questions there. And let's see here. Florence, I love the smart pots that come with the order. I put my romaine lettuce seed in it. That's awesome, Florence. I'm so glad that you're enjoying it. And I really wanna thank you too for supporting our seed shop. We're a small family owned business. And when you purchase seeds from me, I have 30 seed collections, the smart pots, and then my books. When you purchase from our seed shop, it's kind of a way of saying that you enjoy the free content that we put out here, and you're also supporting our small business. So I really do appreciate that as well. Okay, any other questions? Okay, badass Bella, nice to have you on here today. From Ontario, Canada, way up north there. What are good companion veggies for tomatoes? Which to avoid? I always like to plant basil with the tomatoes. I don't know if it really is true, but some people say it makes the tomatoes taste better. I've never really noticed a huge difference, but I just enjoy planting them together because you can pick them at the same time. And then basil sometimes doesn't like it super hot. So tomato plant can kind of shade the basil and they just really grow well that way. If you want something that's gonna help you avoid help with the pests anyway, you might want to plant like some hot peppers or some garlic around your tomato plants. That will definitely help. But I have been recommending a really good book called Plant Partners. It's by Jessica Walliser. She's actually my editor at Cool Springs Press, who published both of my books. And it's an excellent companion planting book. So go over and check that out. And she's got lots more about companion planting in detail. And Nisha, I love that. Yes, marigold is always a good one. How can I forget about marigolds? I've got one right here kind of flopping over. I think the stem kind of broke. But pests don't like the smell of marigolds. So the French marigolds, I believe, are the ones that really work well for that. So definitely look that up. And I always like to plant flowers in with my vegetables to help bring in the pollinators. And it really, I can't believe how many bees and butterflies we have in our garden this year. Well, it's not the white butterflies. You don't want those. Those lay the cabbage looper, lay eggs for the cabbage looper. But the zinnias really bring in the butterflies like crazy. Oh, and I forgot to tell you that when you order today with the summer sale, the code summer, at CaliKimGardenHome.com, you'll also get a free zinnia seed packet. So I've got tons of them growing in my garden. They'll be starting to bloom very, very soon. And borage does self-seed like a beast. It absolutely does. You're going to get a ton of borage in your garden, and the bees absolutely love it. Okay, let's move on here. We've got one more tip to finish off our live stream with, and that is brown spots or yellowing leaves. Now, there are so many tomato diseases that can happen to a tomato plant. I don't even know all the names of them. And I can't even tell you how to fix every single one of them. There's just so many. But one of the very common ones is blight. And some of you get early blight, some of you get late blight, some of you might get both. We don't have tons and tons of problems with blight here for some reason, but I do get lots of yellowing leaves. So blight is one of very common, yellowing leaves are very common. Again, even healthy plants at some point during the growing season will probably get blight or yellowing leaves. It just happens. So what I like to do when there's any issues like that is I prune off the stem or the leaves. What I like to do first off though, because they're so prone to diseases, is to keep the bottom like 6 to 12 inches of the plant free and clear of leaves and stems. So as your plant grows, and look at all the airflow under there, because a lot of times the disease happens because you're not getting enough airflow, or the soil is splashing from the water is splashing from the soil up to the stems and just kind of spreading that disease around. So give your tomato plants plenty of airflow, number one. So prune the bottom 6 to 12 inches of your plant. The other thing I like to do is I never, if at all possible, except when I'm rinsing off some pests of some kind, I don't overhead water or sprinkler water or anything like that. I have drip irrigation all over my garden. Not only does it save a ton of water, it gets the water to the roots where your plants really need it, and then it keeps the leaves and everything dry, which really helps you avoid diseases as much as possible. But when it does come in, I actually just pruned off a couple of leaves this morning, you might see something like this. This is a yellowing, kind of brownish leaf stem that was on the bottom of one of my plants. Or maybe it'll look like this. These kind of look very similar. Blight is when you've got little brown concentric rings and it kind of spreads throughout the leaf. But the best thing really you can do is keep your tomato plants trimmed of these yellow leaves as much as possible, as soon as possible, because it tends to start at the bottom and then move its way up. It spreads very rapidly. So if you can go through every couple of days, I just make a little pass through my garden, I check my plants, and then when you see these yellowing leaves, just go ahead and trim them off and dispose of them. I don't put these in the compost because I don't want to be spreading the leaves to the, or the disease or anything like that through my compost to the rest of the garden. So always trim and prune any yellowing or diseased leaves that you can. As you go throughout the season, you may be seeing more and more of these, because usually when your tomatoes kind of reach the end of their life and it just gets hot, or you know, pests come in and attack, your tomato plants might start looking a little bit raggedy, and you might not have time to keep all of the leaves that are dead and dried up pruned off. So you know what, sometimes you win some, you lose some. It's all in the genetics of the tomato plant. Eventually they're going to die off by frost, or probably by the end of the season they might be looking a little bit ratty. So that's why I always like to get that second round of plants going towards the end of June or July, and that way you have some fresh new plants to take the old ones place that might not be looking so great. So you can also use some organic fungicides. There's a lot out there on the market. Neem oil is a good one to help you control tomato issues. And I know that, I haven't done a lot of this myself, but I know that Gary, and thank you Nisha for posting that, because we do talk about this in the Gardening Coast to Coast podcast. There's some tomato issues there and pepper issues on the last podcast, the last episode, I should say. But he uses baking soda and hydrogen peroxide, and do check out his videos. listen to the podcast for the exact ingredients and how he does that. He's got a ton of videos on that that will be very, very helpful. But again, doesn't mean you're doing something wrong, but just keep a few things in your kind of garden toolkit to help you when problems do come up. Okay, let's pop in here to the chat and answer some more questions. We've got a few minutes left here, and hopefully you guys have some great questions and are growing lots of good tomatoes. And by the way, pop here in the chat what your favorite variety you're growing this year is. I'd love to hear it. Super excited for these golden jubilees coming on, and the sun golds are already starting to produce. Probably one of the earliest tomatoes I have this year is a sun gold. Picked a little handful over the weekend. We've got a little spoon tomato going, which are the cutest little teeny tiny tomatoes you've ever seen. They're perfect for snacking, perfect just to throw on scrambled eggs, which I did over the weekend. Oh, a beautiful butterfly is just flying by in front of me. I saw questions about those white moths. Okay, those are so pesky, and we have had many, many more of them than I normally have. So I've been really checking for the cabbage looper. So what those do is they land on your plants and they lay eggs, which hatch into those little green little inchworms that love to eat just about any plant in your garden. They especially love the kale. They love the brassicas. They can eat the basil, the greens, all kinds of stuff. So the only way to really prevent them from landing on your plants is to cover your plants when they're young. And you got to do it right away. Otherwise, the butterflies get in there, or the moths get in there and lay the eggs, and then they're kind of stuck. But you can, once the cabbage looper comes and starts munching away, you can spray your plants with neem oil to help with that. But I found I just go out and check my plants and pick those little green cabbage loopers off is a really good way to help them out, prevent them as well. And throw them in a little soapy water bucket. Okay, Cliff's excited about giant tomatoes, which are fantastic for eating. They certainly are. I've grown a couple of Cliff's varieties. They're delicious. And by the way, Cliff, I had a whole bunch of the seeds that you gave me sprouted just a couple months ago, and I dropped the whole tray. They all got mixed up. So I planted a couple of them. I don't know what they're gonna turn out to be. So it'll be interesting to find out if you can help me out identify a couple of the varieties once they start producing. Okay, yeah, quite a few white butterflies, definitely. So try those little tips and hopefully that will help. Mr. J Pizza, I think that's how you say that, JP Pizza. I prune armpit sprouts off my tomato plants before they branch and grow big. So that's a great solution as well, or a great little tip to manage the size of your plants. Definitely not something that's completely mandatory, but sometimes that can help you produce larger tomatoes. But that can be hard to keep up with as well. So if that's a method that you choose, that's a great method to go with also. Okay, guys. Oh, and I wanted to say too, if you haven't planted tomatoes yet, it is not too late, especially if you live in a southern climate. You can still plant large variety tomatoes because we have such a long growing season. So I have a tomato seed collection with five varieties you can grab. I have tomatoes in a lot of different places on my website. I have the raised bed gardening. A kitchen garden seed kit is a new one. It's got a great variety of all kinds of different vegetables in it. If you don't just want tomatoes, that's a really good one. And then of course, grab my book. It'll show you how to make the raised bed that I was showing you just a little bit ago. And if you don't want to get as involved to make that type of a raised bed, although it's really pretty easy, there's other builds as well. Or you can grab the Smart Pots Urban Raised Bed. It's a really good pop-up bed. And I talk about tons of raised bed tips in my book, and more about tomatoes really in my first book, Organic Gardening for Everyone. Okay, guys, everything just fell off my table here. I'm gonna sign off for today. I'll be back next Monday at noon Pacific time. And in 2 weeks, we're actually gonna be out at the Rustic Garden Homestead and live streaming from there at the same time. It'll be noon Pacific time. We're gonna stick to that same time. It'll be different out on the East Coast, obviously. And then do make sure you sign up for the event on June 25th. All the links for everything are in the video description. And of course, don't forget to get your 20% discount today with the code SUMMER. All right, guys, great time today. It was great to see everyone, and we'll see you back next week. Bye-bye. Have a great Monday.